What is in my hand?
Watch.
A watch. What is the mode of existence of this watch? Emptiness of, okay, subjective existence. Or emptiness of objective existence. Okay. When you look at it, how does it appear? I'm not asking how does it exist. How does it appear to exist? These were two different questions. How does it appear to exist? And how does it exist? These are two different questions. Okay, I'm not asking how does it exist. You have given a perfect answer to this question. It exists 100% subjectively, no objective existence. But I'm asking you, how does it appear to exist to you? Okay. Okay. Now, when you look at it, still it may be a little bit vague, you know. But you infer from the tone of my voice, oh, he's wanting this answer, right? Okay. When I ask you, you know, just now, don't think that you are Nagarjuna. Think that who are you are. Right? You are who you are. Just think of that. Now answer this. How does this watch appear to be like? Does it appear to be like your mind started to dream of the dreaming pizza? Or, you know, your mind going out is a dream pizza? Or there's a real pizza from outside? Like this, your mind dreaming as a watch or a real watch from there? Okay. The real watch over there, you know, just again speak your mind, you know. Has it something to do? Just speak your mind. Don't think of yourself as Arvindarjuna. Why? Mm-hmm. Tell me the truth. How does it appear? Does it appear to be, you know, it has something to do with my mind? My mind is creating it? No, it's totally independent of my mind. It's really there. Which of the two? It's really there, independent of my mind. This is the meaning of independent existence. This is the meaning of objective existence. Okay, right. Now, you know that, now at least you know in the sense, you can emulate, you can imitate Aranigarjuna saying that, oh, the watch, although it appears to be existent from the object side, but it is subjectively existent. Okay, let's say this, right. Now, the watch is there, but there's no objectively existing watch. But, you know, to us, you know, for us, it appears to be objectively existent. This is number one, mistake number one. Now, how is this watch? Do you like have it? It's Omega watch. You like have it? We don't care. Oh, if it is Omega watch, I'd like to have it. Okay, in true sense, this is just a very simple watch until now. It is not the Omega watch. But then now look, you know, when I said that, when I indicated that this is something so valuable or Omega, made of Omega, you know, it's Omega watch. Then on top of your disruption of the reality, you know, distortion of the reality, objectively existent watch, now you can, you know, you can do another distortion in terms of the characteristics. The watch is the basis. Now, is this good or bad? You are characterizing. Oh, this is so nice, so valuable, you know. This is so valuable watch, worth $10,000. Right. So here, you know, second level of distortion, which we technically, you know, earlier, among the 5 points, is the conceptual misperception. Conceptual misperception refers to, now look, I'm giving the meaning. The conceptual perception refers to, you know, the ignorance which distorts or which gives a false characterization to the basic object. The ignorance which gives a false characterization to the basic object. Right. Okay. While this is just a very ordinary watch, you said that this is objectively existent watch, number one. Number two, you said that it is objectively beautiful and valuable watch. number two. So, and is it always the case that when you see the watch existing as so objectively, you will have craving towards it? Do you follow my question? My question is it always the case that whenever you see a watch or an object existing, you know, objectively, from the object side, craving should automatically come?
No.
Is it always the case?
No.
No. Can anyone give us an example of, you know, seeing a thing existing objectively but no craving coming in? Yes?
If I have a Rolex,
yeah,
then I don't want to watch.
I see. Very good. And something else? And yes?
Like a mirage. When you're driving down, you see a mirage,
but
you don't run after it because you know it's a mirage and not
real. Wow. Very good. Now here, the realization is there. You know, the emptiness of the mirage in water, the realization. Imagine, you don't realize, you have no idea about objective existence, subjective existence, and, you know, such thing. Is it necessary that...
You may not be interested in it.
Like what?
Not particularly like
that. Okay, right. Or a stale food, a rotten food. Rotten food, it appears objectively existent. Objectively rotten food. Actually, there's no objectively rotten food. It's subjectively rotten food, right? But you see it as objectively rotten food. Would you crave for it? No, you will averse. You will have aversion towards it. Right. Okay, now look. So this, you know, when you see an object as objectively existent, then three kinds of emotions can arise in you. If you see it as, you know, objectively beautiful, the craving is uncontrollable. When you see the thing as objectively repulsive, your mind cannot, you know, control the aversion. Aversion is there. This is another disliking, a sense of disliking. This is another emotion, negative emotion. Whereas if it is neutral, or objectively neutral, then there is no attachment, no aversion, but the ignorance. Oh, it is objectively there. Right. So, these three negative emotions in Buddhism referred to as, you know, the three poisons. When you see the object existing objectively from the object side, then the three negative emotions, either of these, you know, one of these three negative emotions is bound to arise. Either attachment, aversion, or ignorance. Clear? Okay. Now, this watch. It appears as from the object side, and since that you have no knowledge of the mode of existence, subjective mode of existence, since you have no knowledge of that, you trust your appearance, you know, you say that, oh, this watch seems objectively existent, and it does exist that way, so you approve the appearance. Right. Mistake number one. Mistake number two. Then you characterize. You give a false characterization to the object, saying that, oh, this is, you know, objectively beautiful, objectively repulsive, or, you know, like that. Objectively beautiful or objectively repulsive. You are giving a false characterization. This is the second distortion of the reality, which we technically call it as what? Conceptual misperception. Okay. So when you see it as objectively beautiful, what happens? Your mind is drawn, pulled towards it. Your mind is pulled towards it. This is attachment. And attachment is one of the afflictions. Right. And then, because of which, you know, if somebody says that, oh, I don't have it, snatch it away from you, then you end up in fist fight or verbal attacking, you know, verbal fight or fist fight or mental fight. So these are the physical, verbal, mental actions. And these give rise to the suffering in the future. Why? So this is the basic thing that we need to understand. Okay. Now the blueprint is becoming clearer. Right. Now from this, what don't you understand? In order to really understand it 100%, you know, the blueprint that I've given you right now, tell me what is still left, which needs to be filled. The missing link. Say it again. Absolutely. How can you convince that this watch does not exist objectively? This is the point. Why? Okay. So now you want to pursue through this, or let me go to Delhi? Okay.